Welcome back to the Chtib and Zhang show. It is episode 23. As always, this episode is brought to you by Hot Streak Fantasy, the best in-play fantasy app on the market. Pick 2 to 3 players in the NBA while you're watching your favorite teams and watch them make you some money. Hot Streak is matching your initial deposit as a bonus, so get Hot Streak Fantasy app now. The app is always bumping right now because of the playoffs. Exactly. Is it the second round now? So a lot of bets are going to be live on the app. So make sure to check that out if you want to make quick and easy money. But this episode, we're going to be talking about the Montreal Canadiens and the Winnipeg Jets and a little Julio Jones. But yeah. As always, roll it. Welcome back to the Chtib and Zhang show, episode 23. Eric, this episode, we of course are talking about the Montreal Canadiens sweeping the Winnipeg Jets in round two to go to round three, first time since 2014. And we'll talk a little about the other series going on, what could potentially be ahead for Montreal coming week or so, Colorado or Vegas, of course. And then we'll talk Julio Jones getting traded to the Tennessee Titans.
Yeah.
So let's start with the Montreal and Winnipeg series. Okay.
Yeah.
Of course, I had the Habs in 7.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we're going there. Okay. Yeah. You had the Habs in 7.
And you had the Jets in 7.
I didn't have the, because the clip is there, man. I've rewatched a clip. All I said was, I'm not making a prediction. And then you peer pressured me to make a prediction. And then what I thought was going to happen exactly happened. Whatever team I was going to root for, people were going to be like, I just want to watch this series. No, because it was just a prediction. Like, I wanted Habs to win the series because I hate Jake more than I hate any Montreal fan. Like, in terms of a fan, like, yo, Jake's not, you won't find a more annoying fan than Jake, bro. Jake, I hope you're watching this. But
deep down, you believed, even though you're rooting for Montreal, you believe Winnipeg.
No, I thought it was like, in my head, it was 50-50.
What was tilting you towards Winnipeg?
Obviously, their sweep, right? They had so much more time to rest. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I thought Scheifele was going to play, but I, that doesn't matter anyways. But it's just Winnipeg looks so good. Yeah. And even the regular season, I think it was 3-3 between them.
Yeah, 3-3.
Like, it was just like, it's tough to say because Montreal, they just beat Toronto. I thought like it wasn't luck, but like I don't know if the momentum was going to, they were going to continue with the momentum. I thought they were going to be tired.
Yeah.
And, but it, to me, it was still a 50-50, like, because they have Hellebuck. Don't forget, Hellebuck's still like a top 5 goal in the league. And I guess the Jets just blew it. Fuck. Jets are.
Yeah, no, you make some good points. You're saying that one thing we talked about when Montreal beat Toronto at the end was Montreal going to get tired going into the second round. Mm-hmm. They played a big series. They played 7 games against Toronto. They had to play physical every game. Weber Petrie played a lot of minutes. So I thought, like you and others, I thought that this team would probably be tired. And that's why I took Habs in 7, because I figured eventually they'd figure it out. But maybe in the first 2 games, Winnipeg would take advantage. But no, that momentum that they got in game 5, game 6, game 7 carried over significantly in the second round. Mm-hmm, and they just kept clicking, like especially the fourth line. Let's give credit to that fourth line of Perry, Armia, and Staal. Like, they were our best line in the Winnipeg series.
Oh, 100%. Yeah.
And another big thing I was talking about they should do is cycle the puck. And that's exactly what that fourth line was doing. Yeah. They could do whatever they wanted in the offensive zone because they were cycling the puck against a fragile decor. And they were able to get opportunities, make the decor turn it over. And that's basically what they did. And that's why they're the best line.
Like even all year, we're talking about how deep this team was. We were talking about Corey Perry, Eric Staal. And then like this series, they actually showed it. Like in the Toronto series, they were like.
They had a good series, though.
Yeah, they weren't bad. But this series, they started scoring more. Like,
oh, yeah.
And if you look at the ice time, like all lines got a good amount of ice time.
Yeah.
I guess Ducharme like has a lot of confidence on his line, which is really
good. For sure. And let's talk about the other coach, Paul Maurice, who's I would say didn't have much confidence in his fourth line.
Oh, not at all.
That fourth line of what? Nate Thompson, Christian Vasilainen, and what's his face? Trevor Lewis. Mm-hmm. He at the start of game 1, he tried to match up that fourth line of Nate Thompson against the Perry line, and it didn't work out. And ever since then, he hasn't been able to match up a fourth line against a fourth line, right? So he had to match up Pierre-Luc Dubois' line with Nick Ehlers or something against this fourth line because it was so good that series. And I think that was the biggest X factor, of course. And so another thing was the Scheifele hit. Let's talk about the Scheifele hit.
Yeah, well, that was a crucial part of the entire series.
So game one, Montreal, who I knew Montreal, I said going into Winnipeg, I talked about with Terry with it on the live stream, is that I watched all the Winnipeg games, and I knew Montreal could skate with this team 5-on-5. They could keep up with them, even though with all their superstars, it was the power plays that killed Montreal in those games. But Montreal penalty kill was really good in this series. Power play wasn't much of a threat for Winnipeg, whereas the Montreal power play was a huge threat, and it was really good.
Yeah.
But the Mark Scheifele hit on Evans. So it's 4-3, minute left in the game. It tied on the power play or something. They pulled the goalie 6-on-4.
Yeah.
So Jake Evans gets a burst of speed, goes around the net. Of course, everyone saw the play. Scheifele's taking 18 strides, hits him, nails him, right?
Evans, he got the N1 though, Jake Evans. He scored though.
Yeah, literally got the N1.
Yeah.
So then I saw the hit. It pissed me off a lot. I knew right away he was getting suspended. There was no way he wasn't. My thought process, though, it was probably going to be one or two games.
Yeah, I didn't know it was going
to
be
four because games. It's the player safety department has been so inconsistent. I'll give it to Jets fans who argue this, that the player safety has been inconsistent. I'll agree with that. It's been very inconsistent this year. You know, Kadri got 8 games. He's a triple offender. But then Tom Wilson doesn't get suspended. I forget who was in the playoffs, got suspended only one game or something. But yeah, it was just so inconsistent during the regular season too. You know, Montreal, Armia was out with a concussion because Tyler Myers hit him. He didn't get suspended. McDavid, the superstar, pretty much just went after Kotkaniemi's face and hit him to the ground, and he only got fined $5,000. So then you think to yourself, George Perros be like, yeah, I owe the Canadians one here. Let me just give it to them. 4 games to Scheifele.
Because don't forget, the thing with Montreal is they have a huge fan. So whenever anything happens in Montreal, there's always noise. And then George Perros, like, he played for Montreal like, for fucking even a couple of games. But like, he knows if he doesn't make the right, like, if he doesn't suspend Scheifele or doesn't give them enough games, like, he's going to get so much backlash. So I feel like,
especially the way
how are you
going
to give him 4 games? And that was
like Jake Evans. Jake Evans was in the stretcher, made it look bad. It was more dramatic.
But don't forget, like, Scheifele, like, first time, like, he never causes any trouble. Mm-hmm. I feel like that was probably, like, he was probably angry at that time. Like,
he was very losing. Oh, that guy was on something, man. Yeah. I don't know if he was, like, sniffing back, like, before the game or something, you know, doing a little snow, but a little blow. You've never done blow before? In the book. But, yeah, his eyes. Did you see his eyes? Dude, no. He was so lost. Like, that was not Mark Scheifele's. Like, just through his eyes, he got pissed off. He took a roughing penalty in the game, because he went after Ben Chiarot when he was down on the ice. Like, he just threw his gloves in his face when Chiarot was down on the ice. So he gets a roughing penalty. He's pissed off. Like, he's like, "What the fuck?" To the ref, blah, blah, blah. So you could already tell he's angry as hell. And then Perry goes after him or something after a whistle or something. And then, like, he just goes after Perry, tries to fight him. And then he does this at the end of the game. So let's break it down. Mark Scheifele in his press conference interview. He's talking about, I tried to negate the goal. That was my first instinct. Negate the goal. Okay. I don't know. Like, I've never played hockey before. You played hockey before.
Yeah.
I keep asking the same question to hockey players. In that play, in that scenario, you're Mark Scheifele. Your first instincts to what? Try and stop the goal, right? Lead with your stick.
Yeah, because if you watch the replay, his stick, like, it was
stick.
Exactly. And, bro, he probably could have stopped it with, like, a poke check or something. Like, if he tried to, like,
this is what happened. I'll tell you what happened. A split second or a second before Evan scores, Scheifele in his brain goes, okay, he's scoring. I know he's scoring. I'm just going to blow this kid out. I'm just going to nail this kid out. I think that's what his thought process was.
Okay, or you can see it as this, like, don't forget, playoff hockey, an excuse for big hits is always like, oh, get the team fired up for next game. Like, just show them, like, we're a physical team, but I guess it back. Like, or maybe that's what it was. Don't forget, this is like 1 second. Like, Shai probably had 1 second to think about this. So,
yeah,
he went for the hit. but
he's played hockey his whole life. He knows how vulnerable
like,
a guy.
If you look at the hit, yeah, it's a vulnerable. Like if I'm playing Chell, like I'm hitting that guy. Like if I see him coming, but it's just like it just looked bad. But to be honest, like it probably would have been a minor penalty, but I don't think like it would have been like a major penalty. Like even
I for sure think so,
no, bro. I've seen
him up high too. It's just like then you get all these people saying, "Why was his head not up? Why was his head not up?" Like I'm like, that doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, but don't
he's going around the net trying to score a wraparound goal. What, he's gonna have his head up while he's trying to do it?
Yeah, but this because it's tough because okay,
it's on Scheifele, man.
Okay, you got this is a weird example, spot. but you know Guillaume.
Yeah.
Okay, he played double. He played 1 year AA, and he absolutely murdered this guy. Okay, he hit him. The guy didn't see him coming. Dropped in. The other guy's helmet fell off.
Yeah.
No, he didn't get anything. No penalty. Nothing. Clean, like it was a clean hit. It was a blindside hit, clean hit, and no penalty. He was in the playoff. It was in the in like their final game too. So,
well, first of all,
and that's like double A too.
Well, no, I but just no play. But I'm
it was
saying,
a humongous. Like everyone talks about that hit, and I don't think Guillaume got anything for it. And
whatever.
But I'm just saying, like,
it's
but don't forget. You have to think about it. You're just a tiny bit biased, right? Because you're a Montreal fan.
No, I will say this. He should be suspended. That's like, okay. There's no way he doesn't get suspended. I was surprised it was 4.
Okay,
fair. I thought it was gonna be 1 or 2. I'll be honest, because of the inconsistency.
But what was illegal about the hit? He didn't hit the head. He hit the shoulder. Yeah, it was like
because his shoulder makes contact with his head because Jake Evans is trying to score a fucking wraparound goal and he's in a vulnerable spot. That's why his head's so low and then he nails him in the head, but. Jake Evans is low.
Yeah, but you ever see like Cronwall hit these people before? Bro, Cronwall used to murder kids, bro. Well,
a different game than when Cronwall was in his prime. Different
okay,
game.
Okay, but still like the I understand.
No,
but
it is a different game. When it comes to like player safety department, it's a different game when it comes to that safety department. It's different from when Cronwall was in his prime.
Way okay, but 100%. No, but even like if I've seen so many, you know, that hit on, what was it? Bufflin's hit on Mark Stone, nothing happened. Like, Subban's hit on Marshall, nothing. Like, it's just things like that.
These are clean hits.
So was the Scheifele one.
Not necessarily.
If you look at it, the guy's going forward. It's not like, and it's not
a blind. He's what's it called? He's charging. First of all, it makes it illegal already. He's charging. It's a charging penalty. It makes it an illegal play already. Sean, dude, he took 18 strides from center ice.
Because don't forget, everyone uses example. Tory Krug, the exact same. And Tory Krug was probably more dangerous because he was closer to the boards, right? And
But I'm saying different outcome.
But I do see it probably merits a suspension. Like it was a pretty like dirty hit. But I don't know.
I see it when you gather that much speed at center ice. And
yeah,
you're coming
it's
in
dangerous.
With that much speed,
it's dangerous for sure.
Like
it's
hitting shouldn't be an option anymore. Not with much speed.
Yeah, it's definitely dangerous. But an excuse that a lot of people use is, bro, it's playoff hockey. But still, like,
his stick and maybe, yeah, you know, hit Evans too, and it was a big hit. But as long as he led with his stick, and you know, maybe one arm was hitting Evans and the other trying to stop the goal, then I'd be like, okay. But he didn't prove to me that he tried to negate a goal in any way. He proved to me that he just wanted to lay the fucking guy out. That's it. That's all he proved to me.
No, but that's fair. But I don't know. He definitely deserved a suspension. But 4 games on Scheifele.
Yeah, I was definitely surprised.
I don't even know why we're still talking about, because you guys were gonna like Montreal was gonna win 100% anyways. Scheifele plays. Scheifele doesn't play 100%.
That's another factor too. Is because without Mark Scheifele.
Hey, you guys swept them. But don't forget, because a lot of these games are like kind of close. So maybe that one goal.
Not most. No. Well, let's look at some of these games. Game one
was 2-1.
It was a wraparound.
Yeah,
we'll see. Yeah, but they have a minute to come back. Okay. Yeah. Whatever.
No, they weren't coming back. But I'm saying like
second
last game.
What was the
OT.
Second game? Second game was like 5-1.
Which one was the second? Bro, this was so recent too.
Game was like 5-1, right? Yeah. The third game was what, 5-2 or something like that?
Okay, I'll be honest. I'm just thinking about yesterday, but like
yesterday was the closest game in the series because it went to overtime.
No, but that's what I'm saying. Like Scheifele plays, Scheifele doesn't play. They're gonna win
100%. Well, here's the thing.
Anyway.
This is the, like the biggest thing Jake was saying to us is like, this, like the Jets were playing their worst hockey of all season. Like, he's never seen them play this bad all season.
Yeah, but it's also Jake.
And you're missing your best player, and clearly because you're missing Scheifele, right? I mean, they look he's clearly their best player. Say what you want about Nick Ehlers and Kyle Connor, but Mark Scheifele, it's so clear to me now. The way they play without him, he is so clear their best player to me.
Bro, he's not winning four games for them.
No, maybe not, but maybe it gets his offense going or something at least.
Okay, but still not four games. Like, it's a sweep. Like, sweep, you can...
But they look so bad. They did nothing offensively. That PLD, this guy has totally lost confidence. Then he had the confidence he had in Columbus. He's totally lost it. Mm-hmm. I think that's the factor of having two guys in front of you in the center position, right? You had Mark Scheifele all season and Paul Stastny in front of you all season. That kind of gets to you, hinders on you. You used to be the first line in Columbus, playing big minutes. You played a big series against guy against Tampa Bay. He played great against Toronto in the qualifying round. He played amazing. And then, like, he gets traded here. He's a third line center. He didn't really, you know, get going at first, and then he loses his confidence, and then, he's not the same player. I do believe next year, I think, hopefully Pierre-Luc Dubois is his self next year.
Bro, I'm probably going to pick him up in fantasy next year, so I need
hopefully, because hopefully I think he'll be his self, because I think this is just, like, the first year jitters that he can't find himself right now, but I think he'll figure it out, because he's a good player. Like, there's no way you play like that in Columbus, and then you just lose it like that in a year.
Yeah, because the thing with Pierre-Luc too is because he's a very good defensive player and he didn't really show in this series. Like,
but it's a very underrated aspect of his game
and
his defense.
And something you can't lose really. Like, you can miss shots or like miss passes, but defense, you don't really lose that. You know what I mean? Like, if you have the speed, like, and if you have all the everything, like, you don't lose that. So,
and that's right, because he didn't really show any like. Of his 200 foot
exactly
like Philip Deneau was just outplaying him he shut down that line, so
because I remember thinking like before, like, Philip Deneau and Pierre-Luc Dubois are actually pretty similar, they play pretty similar,
and he's just more centers. Skilled offensively,
exactly, so
but and he's bigger too, like, this guy's a beast.
He's been a beast. Yeah,
he plays 200 feet. He could score, but like, he totally lost that in Winnipeg.
But he's still a franchise player. I still think he's gonna bounce back.
Hopefully next season. Hopefully he doesn't become like a Tavares. You know, as good as John Tavares is, this guy is not the same player he was in New York.
Yeah,
because he's playing behind my Austin. I'm telling you, when we play the Toronto Maple Leafs, John Tavares looks like nobody. Like, they make him look like nothing because they're playing like Austin Matthews and Mitch Marner just completely dry the offense for Toronto, and that John Tavares just looked like nobody against us.
Cool. He barely played a game.
Yeah, but I'm saying in the regular season too.
Okay.
And I'm saying he's not the same player he was in New York. Not the same player. He was way better in New York, and I don't want PLD to, like, you know, that happened to him because he's playing behind a center, you know, or two centers maybe next year. Mm. Who knows? Hopefully he's a second line center. The future should look like.
Oh, for sure.
Or Perfetti comes up, you don't know. So.
Damn, Perfetti,
So let's talk about it. So Mark Scheifele gets suspended. He's out.
Yeah.
Winnipeg offense, non-existent. Carey Price, playoff Carey Price. He's always himself.
He's amazing,
But the decor was the X factor again in this series. Not again. I'm saying they were a huge... I mean, you look at the point differential that they had in Toronto, points by the decor, and in this series, it was like crazy. It was like 2 points in Toronto, like 11 this series. Mm-hmm. So the D stepped up offensively and defensively. They played some great shutdown minutes in front of Carey Price. Carey Price got he got a shutout this series. We forgot to even mention that.
Yeah.
One of those games was a shutout. So... yeah, and Montreal's offense is clicking. You know, Tyler Toffoli, Suzuki, Cole Caulfield line. Cole Caulfield's starting to get some strides here in the playoffs, starting to look like a serious threat. He's getting shots like crazy. The puck seems to find them. He made a great pass to Tyler Toffoli in OT to end it, pretty much. Chipped it past the blue lineman. Mm-hmm. So, man, if that line could get going, if that fourth line keeps playing like they are, it's the third line that's got
to
get going.
But to be honest, the defense, like, at the beginning of the season, we're talking about, like, maybe, like, the defense wasn't as strong.
I think it was the opposite. I thought I was really praising this the defensive.
Were you?
Well, because I wasn't expecting Weber to go out and totally just drop his game drop off.
But like, I don't know, because I remember at the beginning of the season, I would say, like, Edmondson, he's impressed me. Like, Edmondson's very good. I kind of like
Shea Weber to be his playoff bubble into the end. Didn't. So that's why the decor was so bad. But Edmondson, I liked the signing. Big, long reach. Our decor was like, nobody was under 6 feet.
Exactly. So, that's what you need for playoff hockey. And especially in the next round. Well, because if Montreal can play more big and, like, because remember when St. Louis and Boston, like, those were big teams.
Big,
like,
teams.
Those big are usually the teams that, yeah, those are usually, like, the big checking teams are usually the teams that make it far. If you have depth, like, you need depth too, right?
Yeah.
So, and this, Montreal has everything to
Montreal's
be,
playing, like, right now they're
Montreal,
playing the best hockey.
Yeah, Montreal has everything, like, right now, in the conference finals, right? But if you look at the other teams, they'd probably be, like, maybe third or fourth best team out of, like, all four, like, we don't know who's going to win.
Four?
Yeah, the final four. Like,
they might be
the
worst team out of those
exactly.
Teams.
That's what I'm saying. Sure.
They've been the worst team so far, according to analytics.
But, like, the thing is, like, it's not like they don't have a chance at all. Like, I'd still give them a good chance. And, bro, to be honest, I'm excited to see Montreal for sure.
Listen, Montreal, you got Winnipeg, or no, not Winnipeg, Colorado.
Like Colorado, Tampa. I think
game tonight. So it's 2-2 right now.
Yeah.
And what I've watched from that series is, at first we talked about the Colorado first line, how great, like, they weren't able to stop it in game one, game two. But now in Vegas, that first line, Pacioretty Stone, has done a really good job of shutting down the McKinnon line. So then it gets me wondering, like, Philip Deneau, can he handle it? I think so. I've said,
and don't forget, they handle Marc-Andre Fleury shutting them down.
Marc-Andre Fleury too. So who
and
would
you guys have
play?
Price too. So
would you rather play, you know, Nathan McKinnon, superstar talent, speedy Colorado team, mobile defense? You know, the goaltender is not as good as Marc-Andre Fleury, Philip Grubauer, I believe, but then they have a mobile decor and just a speedy, a forward group overall. Or, and you got to play Nathan McKinnon in that first line. Or do you play Vegas? They have Marc-Andre Fleury.
Pacioretty back in Montreal. I'd love to see that.
They have a big team, big checking team that's going to make it hard for guys like Suzuki, Caulfield, Lehkonen score, the small guys. You know, Suzuki's still going to do his, you know, his stuff, but not get as many chances as he did in Winnipeg, because this is a big checking team in Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, you know, what team, you know, I'd like to see Philip Deneau against a Nate McKinnon, maybe, because I believe you can do it. I believe you can do it, but Vegas, you know, who do we play better? I don't know. Small sample size.
But I'd love to see Colorado go up again. I feel like that's such a good match. Like, it'd be so fun to watch.
I would be way more confident than people, like, the chances people give us.
Oh, yeah, bro. Like, Montreal, like, people still underrate this team just because Montreal doesn't have, like, the superstars like they used to. Like, they don't have, like, a bona fide superstar on the team. Yeah. Doesn't mean you still can't, like, that's the thing. You just, there right now, what Montreal's been showing is they literally have no holes right now. Like, try to name one, like, there's
right now,
literally
the
no
way
one
playing.
Hole.
I don't see any
at the beginning of the season. At the beginning of the season, was, oh, they don't have a superstar, like, who's going to score for them? But all the lines are scoring, it doesn't matter. On defense, oh, they're slow, they're too,
shutting
but
down.
In the playoffs, it doesn't matter. And then Carey Price is playing like playoff Carey Price.
The way they're playing right now, Montreal, the way they're playing right now, hopefully, this little rest doesn't, you know, stop that momentum, because they're going to get a pretty good rest here, which is needed. Of course, you played two series, you know, with no days off pretty much. So it's good to have rest. Always good to have rest for Carey, for Shea Weber. But is that rest going to ruin their momentum that they've
that's what happened. That's what happened in Winnipeg. Yeah.
That's what happened in Winnipeg. Hopefully not. But because the way Montreal's playing right now, if they continue playing like that in the third round, I don't see any team beating them. I just, like, unless that team plays amazing, because Montreal's playing their best hockey of the season. Yeah. They've reached their, I don't even know if they reached their top potential, but they're playing amazing right now. So the fourth line's playing great. I'd love to see them pick it up. Suzuki, Toffoli. It's the Josh Anderson line that needs to get going. Kotkaniemi, Josh Anderson, and Paul Byron. Josh Anderson, you know, if he's not scoring, he's hitting, he's being a pest, that's great and stuff like that. But if they want to win the third round, he's got to start scoring. Josh Anderson's got to start scoring. So.
Oh, shit.
Oh, my God, the fantasy alert.
I know.
So, yeah, Josh Anderson needs to get going a little.
Yeah,
and then, that's it. And then hopefully Jeff Petrie's not – hopefully he comes back. Because if they don't have Jeff Petrie, I don't know about their chances.
Yeah.
They need Jeff Petrie. So hopefully he's healthy coming back for that third round, because, like I said, one of our, probably the best defenseman on our team.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But yeah, guys chipping in. Eric Gustafson playing limited minutes, making the most out of them on the power play. He scores, and the power play is looking great. So hopefully it's clicking in third round. So
you all move on to the next subject.
Yeah, I mean,
we're not making predictions right now, even before any matchup. But just know I have a prediction for next.
Well, we could talk about the playoff series. I mean, Boston, New York's a really good series right now. It's 3-2, I think. New York, right? Yeah, 3-2. They won yesterday. So yeah, that'd be crazy. I still think Tampa's gonna beat whoever comes out of there. So I think it's gonna be Tampa. Yeah. Someone in the finals. Tampa's going to the finals.
And Tampa's winning, but Islanders. I think Islanders might.
I still think Tampa's gonna slap them around. Oh, against no, Boston. No,
against Boston. Oh, that's a very interesting. Like,
I mean, now you got to win two games against Islanders. That's fucking hard.
No, I love how, like, imagine if Islanders have to play Montreal in the final.
That'd be the most boring finals ever. But still, I'm still getting hyped though.
Yeah, for sure.
I hope so. I would love to face the Islanders over Tampa. Oh my God, 100%.
But if Montreal can get past Colorado, they have a good chance against
Friend. Tampa's just so good. I would love to face the Islanders. I would love it. I know Montreal could beat the Islanders. I know they could. Oh yeah, for sure. For sure.
That's fair.
No Tampa. Tampa's just like. They have too much power, too much offense. It's just crazy. I don't know who's gonna beat them, but hopefully it's the Islanders. Hopefully or the Boston Bruins.
How are you doing that playoff fantasy?
Yeah. I'm still first. First. I was down a lot. I was like eighth at one point, but the Tampa boys, they're Alex Korn, man, playoff Korn.
Oh my God.
I took a chance on them. Not a lot of teams have them, so that's what's giving me the advantage.
For sure.
So yeah, Islanders Boston going to game six back in Boston, right? Yeah, back in Boston.
Yeah.
And then Tampa, Carolina play tonight.
I think it's an island.
No, New York's a fourth seed.
Exactly.
Yeah, so game six is. Oh, yeah. Hey, okay, right.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, they just won in NASA Coliseum.
Exactly.
And then we have Tampa, Carolina, 3-1. Mm-hmm. Tampa's going to finish that series out tonight, I think. So,
yeah.
And then hopefully it's the Islanders. That's all I got to say because, yeah, hopefully the Islanders. So, NHL playoffs are soon going to be closing out the second round.
Yeah.
We'll get you your third round coverage probably next week, maybe.
Yeah, for sure.
Hopefully next week. Let's talk about Julio Jones.
Yeah. Let's go.
Julio Jones, Atlanta Falcons. Eric, one thing we predicted was Kyle Pitts to get drafted by the Atlanta Falcons, which he did, and we figured Julio Jones would like that offense, but we were completely wrong.
Yeah, I'm still amazed.
Listen, Julio Jones ain't taking no chances. He wants to win, so he demanded a trade from the Atlanta Hawks. Why am I saying Hawks? Screw basketball. Atlanta Falcons, he demanded the trade, and the Tennessee Titans traded Eric. Football trades, they always boggle my mind.
Oh, always, bro. Even John
Hopkins. What was it, a fourth round pick and a second round pick?
Yeah, yo. How are you getting, like, yo, still
bogged. I guess I don't know football enough because Julio Jones was still one of the best wide receivers in the league. Yeah. I guess it's because an age thing, and I guess because first round picks in the NFL, they always
play. But look at Matt Stafford. Like, how does that work? Like, Julio Jones is on a different planet compared to Matt.
No, but I know. I'm saying just – a first round pick is so valuable in the NFL.
Mm-hmm.
You know, your first round pick's going to play. He could be an altering, you know, player in your organization. So I think that's why first round picks are. But like Amari Cooper got a first round pick and Dallas, you know, for an aging wide receiver. But it's working out right now. But still, like, I was surprised a first round pick for a wide receiver of Amari Cooper. But, you know, Amari Cooper is great in Dallas. So that proved me wrong. But Julio Jones goes to Tennessee for a second and a fourth. He's going to be playing with AJ Brown.
Yeah.
And man, I forget the other guy's name. I feel so bad. The other wide receiver.
Corey Davis?
I don't think he's still on the team though.
Yeah, he's left there.
I think it's AJ Brown. Yeah.
So AJ Brown, Julio Jones, Derrick Henry, Ryan Tannehill.
But yeah, what I don't understand
they needed
is Julio Jones asked to go to the Titans, right? So
Did he ask?
Yeah, yeah, he did.
Okay.
Like, and like AJ Brown, like,
refused. Wait, is that what you're about to say?
No. Wait, what? No.
That AJ Brown what?
No, AJ Brown recruited. That's what I was. Okay. AJ Brown recruited.
I was about to say Jones. He refused, and then he's being fake on Instagram.
But AJ Brown recruited. I don't know if you saw the TikTok of AJ Brown, but like, he wanted Julio Jones on his team.
For sure.
And it's I like that matchup because don't forget, AJ Brown, he's a huge Julio Jones fan. He wears number 11 for Julio Jones, and he plays pretty similar to Julio Jones. So I'm interested to see how that's gonna match up. But to be honest, like, Matt Ryan's better than Ryan Tannehill. Like, Matt Ryan's, like, way better than Ryan Tannehill. Like,
yeah, but Ryan Tannehill, I don't know. Ryan Tannehill is, like, sneakily, it's like, am I saying that right? He's sneaky getting good, you know? And I think, he's a great quarterback in this league. Matt Ryan, we'll see next year because, with his age, he's getting older. We'll see next year, you know?
For sure.
I'm not going to bank all on Matt Ryan because, you know, his age is definitely a factor. You know, could he be like a Tom Brady, age like fine wine? We'll find out.
Nah.
We'll find out. Because his numbers, I think, are going to drop next season.
But don't forget, like, Matt Ryan, this guy, 2016 MVP. Like, Matt Ryan, like, but he can't do anything with just Kyle Pitts and what would they have? Calvin Ridley.
Number one now.
Yeah.
That's going to be insane. That's a guy to look for in fantasy, Calvin
Ridley. Oh, yeah, for sure. Calvin Ridley. He's going to get those yards. But, or are they trying to I don't understand what they're trying to do here.
Listen, they drafted Kyle Pitts. I don't know. I think they're a bit shocked with the trade demand, maybe. I thought Julio was going to try and, you know, at least test the waters with Kyle Pitts and how that offense was going to look. A new coach, too, you know. You know, usually under a new coach, but he's not taking any chances. So, Falcons, they just got to play it out, you know. Mm-hmm. They got to win with the team they have. They're going to have to try and win. Is it good enough? No, not in their division, so. Yeah, it's tough, but Julio Jones, I want to see him win. So I'm glad he's on the Titans. That's going to look good. A.G. Brown and him, that's a duo threat right there.
And
so.
Derrick Henry, the weight room is probably looking crazy.
So the offense, that's definitely something they needed in Tennessee. More depth on the wide receiving core.
Oh, for sure.
Not simply on A.G. Brown. They had good depth last year from Corey Davis, but now with Julio Jones, it's just
even better. That team's going to be so hard to defend because there's so much strength there. Like, in the playoff, that's such a strong team if you think about it. Like, AJ Brown already is one of the strongest players in the league. Now you have Julio Jones and you have
Derrick Henry.
They're gonna be so hard to play. So much CTE coming out of this game, those games against them.
That's gonna be fun, man. That's gonna be Tennessee Titans, already a fun team to watch. Like you said, Derrick Henry, he's a beast. The thing is, they don't throw the ball a lot. In Tennessee,
that's what I was thinking about too.
So obviously Julio Jones, his numbers are going to be less than last year. I think he had because they give the ball a ton to Derrick Henry. But still, I mean, what's wrong with having plus a second round pick and fourth round pick? I don't know why people don't jump on this more. Who knew what the other trade packages were for Julio Jones? Or maybe he only wanted the Tennessee Titans. But if I was a GM, a second and a fourth. Because I still believe in Julio Jones. Yeah. Like, come on. I don't know. Like, I don't get these football trades. I'd call more teams about their vets, you know? I'd do that.
I'm saying, like Hopkins got traded for a second rounder and David Johnson. Like, bro, it's just like,
how's like Hopkins not going for a first? That's ridiculous.
I still don't understand how that works, but
it boggles my mind sometimes, the NFL.
But I'm excited to see because the thing with Tennessee is they're very reliant on Derrick Henry in the playoffs, all the time. And the other teams, they know they're going to go to Derrick Henry, but now they
can change their game.
Now,
a run and pass.
Exactly.
You know, so that's what happened. The Tampa Buccaneers. That's how they won the Super Bowl.
Exactly.
Because at first they couldn't run the ball.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they figured it out, they're running the ball crazy in the playoffs. They were throwing the ball and they became that dual offensive threat and they won the Super Bowl because of it. Exactly. And their defense. And they had great defense.
Yeah.
So it's going to be fun to watch for sure. Julio Jones, hopefully, you know, they can get into the playoffs, do something serious. I'd cheer for them. Cheer for Julio. I always draft Julio in fantasy football.
Yeah, so. You do, huh? No, you trade for him last year too.
I traded him for him last year for sure. If I don't draft him, I trade for him.
But I don't think I'd pick up Julio Jones this year in fantasy because him and AJ Brown are going to split a lot of yards.
Yeah, that's why Calvin really going to be looking real nice.
Calvin really is going to be looking nice for sure.
So Yeah, so that's it for the episode. We talked a little Jets Habs. Next week is going to be more jam-packed for sure. Round going underway. Montreal's opponent will be known.
And don't forget, there's a UFC fight this weekend.
And
too,
UFC fight for sure. So definitely, what is it, UFC 263? Something like that?
263 or 4, I forgot. But is Adesanya fighting? Adesanya's fighting. Yeah. Nate Diaz is fighting too. So
okay, so a lot to jam to unravel there.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, thank you again for listening to the Chtib and Zhang Show, episode 23, I believe. So tune in next week. Like you said, round 3 of the playoffs. Make sure to tune in. We'll see you next week. Ciao. Peace.
Peace out.